Because if they do, I'm in, baby. I'm going. I just celebrated a nice anniversary. My 1 year anniversary of a rent stabilized apartment. Huh? Yeah, real New Yorkers know the value of that shit. People from other parts of the country come to New York, have money to pay this ridiculous rent, you know? I also celebrated another anniversary, 6 months with the same therapist. How about that, huh?
Yeah.
And she has empathy. She's not a clock watcher. She accepts me for all my baggage, and she accepts my Medicaid. So let's give it up for that socialism one more time, huh? And because I believe all good things come in threes, last year I quit my day job, and I'm doing comedy and acting full time now, folks, full time. Thank you. Which means pretty soon I'll be able to qualify for EBT, so. Where my Bernie bros at, huh? Yeah. It was rigged, I tell you. Oh. I'm trying to watch my diet, you know? Not because I want to lose weight, I just want to have less upsetting shits. You know? You know what I'm talking about? So when you get older, shits become violent. The plumbing don't work as well as it used to. Remember when I was in my 20s, I can eat chicken wings, bone it all, just swallow them like a fucking goat. You know what I'm saying? Now I just smell Tabasco sauce and I gotta take a shit. Any other Ashkenazi Jews out there, huh? Here's a question. We're deep thinkers, Ashkenazi Jews, very deep thinkers. So I have a question for you. Which came first? Anxiety or having this shit because of it? Hmm? Do I have a poor digestive system that makes me anxious? Or does my anxiety make me have a poor digestive system? Give it up if you've got that old friend that wakes you up in the morning, anxiety, huh? Give it up for anxiety, yeah. Who needs an alarm clock when you have an inner monologue? You're gonna get up, but people don't want to see you. You're nowhere in your life where you're supposed to be, asshole. Anxiety. It's hard when you deal with anxiety when you're sober, too, you know? It's hard, because you have to start repurposing the natural order of things. Like things you did for a certain reason when you were younger have now been repurposed. Like when I was 20 years old, I'm just gonna be honest, I used to jerk off so I didn't kill people, all right? Fair, right? Now I'm 40 years old, I jerk off just so I can get a good night's sleep. Where my stress jerk is at? Stress jerkers, make some noise. When the weed and the Ambien ain't cutting it, you gotta take matters in your own hands. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
You gotta take matters in your own hands. Woo! Amen. I wanna ask you a question. What's your name?
Alberto.
What is it?
Alberto.
Alberto. I wanna ask you a question. You ever come so many times in a row that you were afraid what's gonna happen next?
Yeah.
I said you ever come so many times in a row, you're afraid what's gonna happen next? Is it gonna be semen or bone marrow? You ever come so hard that you're afraid your soul's gonna escape? What have you?
Yep.
Yeah.
Hell yeah.
Women know how to stress jerk. You've been doing it for a long time. You know why women have much higher, contrary to popular belief, I sincerely believe that women have an innate ability, genetically predisposed, to have higher self-esteem. You know why? Because you know how to love yourself well. Yes. You don't need a partner.
need a woman or man. You just need nice fucking bath bombs, nice candles, and a glass of fucking wine. And because if you can't love yourself, if you can't love yourself, then who can? I said, Alberto, if you can't love yourself, then who can?
Jesus?
Yep.
Got really weird. I just had this vision of like you growing up in a very religious Catholic, because I assume you're Latino?
Si.
Donde was that?
Colombia.
Colombiano! Were your parents strict Catholics?
Yep.
So there was a picture of Jesus in your house?
Yep.
Did you ever jerk off and like were afraid that he was watching?
In front of him, yeah.
Ah! Somebody's got a kink. I look into his eyes and jerk my shit. Oh yeah. Somebody's got a kink. I'm gonna win the prize and burn in hell. You see, this is art. I'm creating stuff right now. I like that. It's nice, right? It's very refreshing. It's very refreshing. What do you think the gateway drug is, Alberto? You think there is one? You ever hear that? In America, we have a lot of talk about the gateway drug. You guys believe that there's sincerely a gateway drug? Do you think there's a gateway drug?
No.
What do you think it is?
It's weed.
It's weed? That's what you think? Okay. Anybody else want to chime in?
Yeah.
You say weed?
Trauma.
Of course Danny would say that. Yeah. Anybody knows Danny? That's his porn. Ooh, resentments. Damn, nobody loves me.
Damn.
I think you're on to something, all you guys, but I'm gonna tell you, you know what the real gateway drug is? Sugar. Because when you're a child, it's the first thing that you're given as a fucking reward.
Yeah.
Right? If anybody grew up in a neighborhood in the United States of America where there was an ice cream man, make some noise if there was an ice cream man in your neighborhood.
Yeah.
And you'd hear that, thank you. And you'd hear the noise, you know. And what would the kids do when they heard the ice cream man?
Good to see you.
What would they do? I heard somebody say, what would they do?
Run.
That's right. Because they were little fucking addicts, fiending. Right? And I'm not saying that pedophilia is right, not for it, but I can understand why a kid would suck a dick for a Snickers bar.
Woo!
I went there. Sure did. Now, one more thing I want to say, and then I got you guys are a wonderful audience. Give it up for yourselves. Matt, one more thing. You got to do due diligence when you're in the red room after midnight. Oh, yeah, here it is. Yeah. People underestimate the power of scaffolding. Huh? New York City scaffolding is some serious multi-purpose shit. Right? Do you know what scaffolding is? Scaffolding is like, oh no, I forgot my umbrella. Scaffolding. Oh, I don't have a place to live. Scaffolding. Oh, I gotta do a workout. Scaffolding. You can fucking work out, stay dry, and have a place to live. And you ever notice that scaffolding is there for years? You don't even know how long it's fucking been there. You don't know when it's coming down. You know why? Because scaffolding makes New York a better place. Let's give it up for scaffolding, everybody.
Yeah. Yep.
And I will conclude my set with a little serenade song about my shows this week.
Woo.
You can catch me on Thursday at Uck Billy's.
Woo.
In the dispensary in Greenpoint. I'll be hosting that motherfucker.
Yeah.
On Saturday, you can catch me in Brooklyn.
Woo.
At 7:30 at the Secret Pour. Bump, bump. And next Wednesday, at St. Mark's Comedy Club, you can catch me for my monthly show. Woo. Midweek crisis comedy. So if you like what you heard, say yeah.
Yeah.
And if you want to keep up more, say yeah.
Yeah.
And you gotta follow me at Lee Paul.
comic rock star on Instagram. Say yeah. Yeah. Good night.
Woo!
Hell yeah. Oh my God.
The master, oh my God, the craft, the seminar, running a seminar, it's a clinic, oh my God, unbelievable. Give it up for Lee Paul, everybody. Wow, amazing, 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 amazing. Okay, we have so many amazing acts to get to. We're going to do this, okay? It's Punchline. It's just like that movie Punchline, okay? Sally Field and Tom Hanks and all those other people. Okay, is Bob Royer in the house? We really wanted the indie sleaze Bob Royer. Ah, it's a loss for the ages. Yeah, it's really a lost masterpiece. Fuck. Okay, well, we still have so many masterpieces left. This next comedian is so funny, it's insane. I can't wait. Let's just give it up for Alberto Botero!
So, I left Colombia about 20 years ago, and then I started going back about 5 years ago. It's a weird story. I've been looking for my father's killer. For 5 years, I've been looking for my father's killer. So far, nobody wants the fucking job. No, I'm kidding. He's dead. Alzheimer's. That's all good. So, to honor his memory, or their lack of, I wrote me some dad jokes. Because, I mean, we don't have a lot of dads in Colombia, so we don't have dad jokes. So, but these jokes might not be good, but neither was his parenting. So. What do food fetishes give to each other for Christmas?
What?
Mistletoe. Who lives on a pineapple under the sea? The Cubans that didn't make it to Miami. How do you make us immigrants feel welcome?
How?
Don't feed us. Don't give us food. What is the favorite game of immigrants?
Okay.
Rock, scissors. We don't have papers. What is the favorite game of the homeless?
Okay.
Hunger Game.
Oh.
What is the favorite TV show of Colombians?
George Lopez.
No, whose line is it anyway? You see? Dad jokes are cute. Dad jokes are like kids with cancer. They never get old. Why do Indians from India cannot be ninjas?
They can't.
Because you smell them coming. Oh. Have you ever, like, have you guys ever, like, after the holidays or holiday dinner, have you guys pooped so well, it's so complete, so everything, that you feel lonely afterwards? No. You need a hug and aftercare? You question your sex life? Okay. If you see a toilet in your dreams, don't use it. More than a joke. It's not squirting if it comes out of her eyes. Once I met a girl, so I thought she was so slutty that when she was a toddler, she probably used to sit on her pacifier. Slut shaming is bad, by the way. Don't slut shame. But lady, or ladies, you could be sluttier. Okay, I'm canceling that one. So period sex may bring couples together, like it's a thing, right?
Yeah.
So is it a blood pact? Why do gays cannot work at sperm banks? Drinking on the job.
Oh, wow.
The day after, have you guys had to chip in with your friends for Plan B?
What's that like? Oh, okay. Thank you.
This is gonna get worse. Why do women should always wear underwear if they wear skirts?
Okay.
Dandruff. Come on. This isn't the memory of my dad. He died from Alzheimer's, so did he forget how to live? How do you get gum out of your hair?
Cancer.
Of your hair?
Cancer.
Cancer. Oh shit, you knew that. Damn it. Why do men have pre-cum and then cum? Because God was wise and he knew we always have to repeat ourselves. Nah, goddammit. Why do priests always baptize, Catholic priests, baptize kids in water? Because you always have to wash your sex toys? Do you guys think abortion doctors are disgruntled pediatricians? Okay, thank you very much.
Yeah. Hell yeah.
Yeah. Woo.
Okay. Stop shit. Yes.
Is that from Truly Tasteless Jokes? Have you ever read that book, Truly Tasteless? Has anybody read that book? Oh
no,
my
but
god.
Is it? Wait.
I've heard that dandruff joke, definitely.
Which one?
The one about dandruff.
Really?
Truly Tasteless. Get yourself Truly Tasteless Jokes, okay? Do yourself a favor. Go get Truly Tasteless Jokes.
I'm going to
learn. Okay. We found these glasses. If anyone lost glasses, we found your glasses. So we want to return them to you. Give it up one more time. Hilarious.
Yeah.
In honor of your father. I think that's amazing. You want to avenge his murder. You're going to Mexico to avenge his death. I think that's badass. Oh, I'm sorry, Colombia. Colombia?
Yeah.
Yeah, Colombia. Sorry, I didn't mean. All right, I'm an asshole. All right. Anyway, no. We'll cut to that. We'll edit that out. We'll go back. We'll edit that out. When I run for president. All right. Anyway. Oh my God, we have so many powerhouses. We have Lola on deck. We have Peter Girl coming up.
Wow.
Ruby, Addison Anderson, Mina Laura. I'm not sure if any of these people are here. I don't think they are. Matthew Houts. I'm not sure if he's here. Danny Fallon, we know, is in the house, and Joe Levy. And we have an amazing, magical night. I can't wait. This guy is hilarious. I'm so glad he's coming out. Give it up for Jack Barth, everybody.
Let's go.
Yeah.
My favorite joke on the last show was the gay guy at the sperm bank one.
Oh my God. I like
that. Because it implies that when a gay guy sees sperm, he just like has to drink it. Like immediately. He's like plotting, he's like, I'm gonna work at the sperm bank and drink all the cum. And he's like, did you hear about that new guy? Is he gay? And he's just in the room like, I'm so thirsty, I have to. Okay, that's my favorite one. When I was a kid, I was really bad at sayings. You guys know the saying, play it by ear, it means to like improvise, play it by ear. I thought it was play it by year. So it's like, yeah, man, we'll do it this year, but maybe next year, you know, who knows? We're going to play it by ear. And then I also thought it was, instead of taken for granted, I thought it was taken for granite. And I'm like, yeah, man, granite's a pretty common rock. You should take it for like ruby or sapphire, you know, pretty more expensive gemstones. There's other examples, but it's getting repetitive, and I wouldn't want to beat off a dead horse.
Yes.
Wow. That was a single. All right. I have some dating material I have to work out, so sorry about that. I think what annoys me about dating in New York is, like, there's so many options that it's, like, if you have, like, one misstep in the dating process, then it just, like, derails the whole thing. Like a few months ago, I almost gave this girl the ick, and the ick was chlamydia. I almost gave this girl chlamydia. I said almost, so here's what happened. We went on two dates, went well, had a romantic kiss in the rain. Wow, it's just like The Notebook. Third date, hooked up, my dick didn't work. That's not in the notebook. That's not in the note. There's no scene where Ryan Gosling can't get hard. And then the next day he orders Blue Chew. That's not, I did that, I ordered Blue Chew. I'm a customer, I like it. But also, yeah, when your dick doesn't work, you gotta eat her pussy. That's what you gotta do. I don't make the rule. That's, you know, I can't have her leave do nothing. You know, I have to do something. A funny thing that happened when I ate her pussy is that she said, Jack, I want you to fuck me. And I was like, yeah, me too. We both know that can't happen right now. That's why I'm down here. I felt like I was withholding something, like a parent, you know? I was like, you get what you get, and you don't throw a fit, you know? I said that, and she came immediately. I don't know. She had some issues. So, that happened, and then 2 days later, my left ball started hurting. I know, the logical one. I don't... the mathematical one. Still have my creative one on me though, so that's how I wrote the bit. So then I went to the doctor, and the doctor, I told him everything, and he's like, you probably have chlamydia. And I was like, that means I have to tell the girl, you know, which sucks. And like, I feel like chlamydia's got like a negative stigma. I'm the only guy fighting against this stigma in the world. So I, like, people, when you say you've had chlamydia before, I've had it. And they just think you're like a sex freak, you know, like you fuck all the time. And I can count on two hands how many times I had sex last year. 1, 2, 3. I had sex 3 times last year. I needed the mic stand just for that part. And so I came, and chlamydia, like, super chill. If you're looking for an STD, that's the one to get. That's what I'm saying. If you're in the market, she was not. It's like, you take antibiotics, it's gone in 24 hours. Super easy. So I told her about it with that energy, and like, if you haven't had it, I could see how that would be annoying, you know, like she would be scared, and then I'm just like kind of nonchalant about it. Like, I was like, hey, I might have chlamydia, and she was like, well, your dick didn't even work. And I was like, I bet you're pretty stoked about that now, huh? You know? I bet you're pretty happy. And then I was like, I had to explain, like, no, it's actually, if you do oral, then you can transmit that way. And then I added, as a little bit, I was like, and if the oral's, like, really good, then it can be, like, transmitted really easily. And big thumbs down in the messages. Big, thumbs down from her, as you can, that checks out. That checks out a lot of things. Oh, that, you thought it was my art. Thanks, Joe. So she didn't really want to, like, see me that much anymore. And so she got tested negative. I got tested also negative. I never even had chlamydia in the first place. Dude, I hate that doctor so much. Never go to MedRight Urgent Care on Flatbush Avenue. I think he just tells everyone that they have chlamydia. You know, if anything's wrong with your dick and balls, he's like, yeah, this is what it, like, someone could show up to that urgent care and he's like, yeah, someone cut my dick off with a knife. And he's like, that looks like textbook chlamydia. Really looks like chlamydia. Oh, it's bleeding profusely. Yeah, no, that's chlamydia. I learned it in med school. So, she's like, she didn't want to see me. She's like, I gotta work on myself. I was like, just say it's the chlamydia, you know? Don't act like you're gonna, like, learn Spanish or something right now, you know? So what do we learn from this story, guys? Is that not only would chlamydia derail a dating process, is that the idea that you might have it, that someone out there thought you might have it eventually, could derail it. She texted me after that. She's like, hey, I've been talking to my friends, and I told them this chlamydia story, and we all thought it was really funny, and now we call you the chlamydia comedian. And she couldn't even think of the chlamydian. Am I right? Fucking, oh my god, I can't believe it. Anyway, that's pretty much all I wanted to work on. Thanks, guys. Yeah.
We love it, we love it, love it. Give it up for Jack Barth, amazing, hilarious, honest. But only hot people get chlamydia, alright? Don't let anybody else tell you otherwise. That's the law of supply and demand. Give it up for Jack Barth one more time. He's a monster of comedy. He slam dunked it. It was incredible. Alright, we have so many amazing acts left. This next act, we're super stoked about. Give it up for the hilarious Lola. Can we get Lola up? Give it up for Lola.
Hi, everybody. I'm actually not doing a set. I actually work here. That's why I'm wearing this. I just need you guys to collect the cups and put them on one table when you leave, okay? Just like, I don't know. Whatever, usually it's like whatever table has the most shit on it seems most convenient. I'm not fucking kidding. Thank you. How's everybody's year been so far? Did anything interesting happen to anybody? Does anybody want to share? I'm obviously setting up a joke, but I do want to hear one comp. Did anybody?
I haven't jerked off yet.
You haven't jerked off yet? Dry January.
Yeah.
Have you woken up wet?
Yeah.
Okay, well then you failed.
Yeah.
Well, that's okay. You can't have success without multiple failures. Well, I started the year off great. I went to a rave. I went to my first rave. I went with my psychiatrist.
Woo!
And he dosed me out MDMA, and then he was like, hey, you know what'll help you let go is a microdose of mushrooms, too.
Sure.
So take these together. And then I put a booster in my sock, because we went to Avant Gardner. Has anybody been to Avant Gardner?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Oh, Mirage. Yeah. I love Avant Gardner. It's like, does anybody know who Temple Grandin is? She is like a famous for being autistic and super into cows. She developed this slaughterhouse system that's circular. The cows like to walk in a line. They're calmer if they walk in a line. And they walk in this big circle all the way to the nail gun, right? And that's what Avant Gardner is like. It's like checkpoint after checkpoint after checkpoint. And they yell at you. They're like, everybody over there in that line. And we're all like wearing tiny clothes. And we're like, oh, I'm sorry. And then they get to like the checkpoint. They got this Home Depot bucket full of like all your good shit. And you just know they're snacking on that in the back. They like take whatever, because you can't have drugs there. They like touch all your stuff and they like pat you down for real. They're like, it's like that should be the airport. Move those people to the airport. Move the airport to Gardner. Anyway, I was a real pussy about taking the drugs because I'm a stoner. Like, and I have a bad time coming down from edibles. Sometimes I'm like, oh, I'm a little sluggish today. You know. So like taking hard drugs, I was like, well, fucking whatever. Well, I'm gonna be a little sleepy. Sorry, it's my pen.
Yeah!
Why did that kill? Why did you guys fucking love that? Should I do it again? All right, here, let's see. Maybe it'll fall. And I was like, maybe I'm gonna have a bad time. And my psychiatrist was like, well, nobody has a bad time on MDMA because it blows out all your serotonin, right? It's the feel-good switch. You can't have a bad time. So I go, and it starts kicking in, and I start, like, sighing, and then it becomes like, oh shit, this is good shit. And the music is like, doo, 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 the dumbest music in the world. That's why this is the greatest drug to do. And so, it was a while ago. This was weeks ago. It was the first day of the year. Weeks ago, whenever the first day of the year was, 2-3 weeks. I went from doo, doo, to like shivering with a hoodie on like a cartoon junkie, and I started having a really bad come down. Like I like got sick, and so then I called every hotline. The 2 days after the rave, I called 911 because I woke up and I was like shivering and I couldn't get my heart rate down, and I was like, oh my god, I'm having a latent reaction. And I deleted all my texts from all time from my psychiatrist because I was like, I'm gonna die, and then they're gonna arrest him, they're gonna call him a quack for the rest of his life, you know. So what's really fucked up is the first thing I did when I called 911 is I googled 911. And I realized what I was doing. I'm like, because what came up was a TV show called 911. I'm like, I'm not watching TV right now. And then I called 911, and when I panic, I become very calm. So the person, they pick up instantly. And I'm like, hi. I can't seem to get my heart rate down no matter what I do. I was wondering if you could send an ambulance or something. That would be really helpful. They like ask for my address. And the guy's like, he's like, do you want me to stay online with you? And I'm like, that would be really great. By the way, do you ever get people who tell you they can't afford the ambulance? And he's like, yeah, all the time, but it's fine, don't worry about it. So the ambulance parks outside my apartment, and I go in, and I'm like shivering, right? And they're like, oh, you know, what's wrong with you? I'm like, I can't get my heart rate down. And they stick all this stuff to me, and it's like, I've done a lot of background acting, and I've noticed that police officers and EMTs and firefighters, they all seem fake to me because you can just buy those clothes and like sign up for background acting and they'll let you do it because you get like a bump actually in pay if you have the uniforms. And these guys seem so fucking fake. Like there's one guy who's like, hey, I'm the funny one. And the other guy's like this dutiful EMT who's just like sticking shit to me. And the funny guy has the iPad and he's like, hey, so what do you do for work, Lola? And I'm like, I work at a comedy club. He's like, oh, you know any good jokes? And I was like, shh, I'm like convulsing. And I'm like, hey, I'm convulsing, what's happening? The good EMT is like, oh, you're making adrenaline. You're having a fight or flight response. I'm like, okay. So I'm doing like this, and the guy's like, you know any jokes? I'm like, oh, I know a really dirty one. And I'm like, can I tell you? And he's like, well, my wife's not here, so that's fine. I'm like, okay. And I'm like, you know, a guy walks into an elevator, and there's a lady already in there. And he's like, uh-huh. And I'm like, and the guy says, excuse me, ma'am, can I smell your vagina? And she says, absolutely not. And he says, oh, it must be your feet then. And it's at that point I start to chill out. And I start to be like, you know what? I don't need to be in an ambulance anymore. I'm actually done with the ambulance. And I stand up and I'm like, thank you, gentlemen, for your time. And I never got a bill. At least for the past 2 weeks I haven't got a bill. Fucking shout out for that. I only forgot about me. That's the most expensive. If that bill comes, that's the most expensive panic attack I've ever fucking had in my life. All it took was for me to steal a guy's joke that I heard at the comedy club and go back and lie down. And so then I called all these hotlines. And by the way, I love the fucking suicide hotline. You should always call me. The suicide prevention hotline. They need to update the hold music though, because when I called, it was a little too funky. I don't have the exact song because I couldn't Shazam it or anything. But I do have a song that I'd love to play for you now because this is the same vibe. Okay.
Wow. Hello, caller. There are two callers in there. Don't do it.
I'm sorry that I did that. I've called the suicide prevention hotline so many times that I like know all their tricks and questions. They're like, they have a script, they like want to know, you know, hey, are you in the middle of killing yourself? And I'm like, no, I'm just thinking about it. I kind of, you know. When I called the substance abuse hotline, that lady, I did not meet her expectations. She was trying to move that shit along, you know, to somebody who really needs help. She's like, oh, this pussy, she just can't handle MDMA. She, you know, it's like, chill out. You're currently making serotonin, like, every day when you sleep. So, you know, take a nap. But she was like, you know, other callers have described feelings of hopelessness. Do you feel hopeless? And I'm like, I mean, not any more than usual, you know? I got off the phone with her a few days later. I took Mucinex because Avant-Garden is a fucking super spreader venue. That's a bajillion people breathing into the air. And I'm sorry, I just did it now. Just wait 2 weeks, we'll find out what happens. But I called the poison control, and that was my favorite fucking hotline. If you don't have healthcare, you should always call the poison control line because they exist to calm you down. I took one dose of Mucinex, and I felt a little dizzy, and I'm a hypochondriac, so I always read like the shit that could happen to you in the instructions, and it says, call your doctor if you feel dizzy. I called poison control, and I was like, hi ma'am, I've taken one dose of Mucinex, and I feel a little funny. Am I dying? She's like, well, tell me what the active ingredient is. And before I could say it, she asked me, she's like, is it this, some rifampicin? And I'm like, yeah, it is. She's like, oh, well, there's your dizziness right there, and you know, how you feeling? And I'm like, I feel a little stoned. She's like, oh, well, now you know why people abuse it. And she's like, yeah, you know, people drink this stuff all the time. Some kids like that. Some kids like that dizzy. I'm like, some kids like that? This is the fucking best lady ever. She's like, listen, this is actually better. I think this is actually better than the suicide prevention. Because her last line to me was like, listen, I don't see it doing anything but getting better than this. It's just going to get better and better from here on out. So just chill out, don't take any more of it, and have a great day. That's fucking healthcare. That's healthcare. And that's all I want to say to you.
Yes!
Thank you.
Amazing. Holy shit.
Lots of great life tips in that one. I'm going to call the suicide prevention hotline tonight. I mean, that's just a great tip. I mean, how did I not think of that? And that's the music. God, amazing. Give it up. Give it up for Lola, everybody. Killing it. She killed it. She killed it. That was amazing. That was hilarious. Smart. We loved it. All right. We got a few more amazing acts. We're going to get to it. We have, we have Danny Fallon coming up. We have Joe Levy coming up. Can we get Peter Girl? Give it up for Peter Girl. This guy's hilarious. This guy's a killer. Give it up for Peter.
Know that guy.
Yeah.
That was a wonderful story about your inability to tolerate MDMA.
Thank you.
I am going to keep the theme going. It was how I realized that my antidepressants were working, was I went off them for a couple of days and took some ecstasy. And I was doing a couple of bumps of cocaine, you know, with the ecstasy, as one does.
Yeah.
But then, yeah, I took the ecstasy on a Sunday. And then Monday came around and I was like, holy shit, I'm sad today. And I was like, wait, why am I so sad? And then I remembered, oh, that's what's supposed to happen after you take ecstasy or MDMA. You're supposed to be sad the next day. It's not supposed to, because you're already so tapped out in your serotonin levels, it's not supposed to not do anything and then you carry on the next day as normal. What a wonderful realization that was. I sat there and I was like, oh, but I was like, well, this, the highs and the lows, right? That's what you're supposed to. I was like, oh, I am enlightened right now. I am enlightened. Speaking of being, God damn it, I was on a roll there and you had to move the chair. Now, speaking of being enlightened, yes, my name is Peter Girl, which is very confusing for bisexual women. For a second, they're like, oh, he? And I'm like, yes. And they're like, but she? And I'm like, also yes. We'll figure this one out later on. Later on. Yes, yes. No, I was doing dry January. Well, no, I wasn't doing dry January. I was attempting to quit drinking. Notice how I say attempting. Because I immediately got the flu right after I quit the drink. So clearly, drinking is very important for my health and well-being, you know? Because usually that's why people do dry January, is because, you know, they, like Lee mentioned, they want to be healthy, they want to be trendy. Whereas the reason people do sobriety is because they're at the end of the line of being healthy, they've exhausted all other options. And dry January usually ends with a big party. Quitting drinking usually begins with a big party. There's no alcohol there, though. But I'm the asshole for wanting to have a drink at a children's bowling birthday party, you know? Ah! Sorry, I'm susceptible to bright lights. Earlier when Kogo was going and you were hitting the lights on and off, I was like, that'd be awesome for a comedy set. Just, you know, nightmare, 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 like Eric Andre. There we go. There we go. That's fun. Now I'm having an epileptic seizure and I'm going to power through. But no, it's not that I need the drink. It's that I just enjoy doing it, you know? It's like seriously, like if you go to a children's bowling birthday party and you're just sitting there watching everybody else bowl, you're going to want to show the kids how it's done, you know? Yeah. You're going to want to show them how to do it.
Hell yeah.
Or you're at the batting cages, right? And kids are one after the other and you're like, I got to show these kids how to load and explode. I'm exploding on all these kids.
Yeah.
That's so fucking stupid. I can't believe I said that, but I'm happy I did. I'm happy I did. What the fuck else do I want to try? Oh, I've been watching a lot of movies. Well, if you could tell, I've gotten back on the drink for my health. For my health. Remember that episode of Drake and Josh where Drake and Josh have a bet and Josh stops playing video games and Drake stops eating junk food and he immediately gets like deathly ill and the doctor's like, Drake, you gotta eat the candy. That's what happened when I went to the doctor for the flu. She was like, oh, you quit drinking. I think the drink was killing the flu virus. And I was like, ah, just like my Irish ancestors. They knew what they were doing when they drank. Yes, Ireland. Yes. But no, so I've been watching a lot of movies because that's all you can do when you stop drinking. And I figured out movies from like the 80s and 90s. Basically all of Spielberg's discography. Is that a videography? Ography. Spielberg's ography. I realized, you know, Jaws 1, it's a shark. Jaws 2, it's a bigger shark, right? Jurassic Park 1, it's a dinosaur. Jurassic Park 2, it's a bigger dinosaur. Schindler's List 1, it's a list. Schindler's List 2, it's the memories we made along the way. That's what it is. I pulled the mic out just to say Schindler's List, which I have never actually seen. I was born in 2000. I know, it surprises everybody. My ass wrote a check that my face can't cash. The snaps, thank you. How am I doing on time, Mr. Proctor? How am I doing on time?
Say 1 minute.
1 minute? Perfect. 1 minute? I'll just keep talking about the wonderful skincare routine that I keep. No, I was doing an open mic at the Cupboard once, which is already a depressing sentence. It is, but I mentioned that I was 23 and I got off the mic and the host went, I got one word for you, retinol. And I was like, oh, let me write that down, but oh. It's always my favorite thing to do is just, if no one laughs, just sit there until somebody laughs out of feeling awkward. Just like at an orgy. Okay, alright. Okay, it's time to wrap it up. What am I going to wrap it up with? I think that Sisyphus, you know, from mythology, I think he listens to Kate Bush's Running Up That Hill constantly. And he always starts it over. The boulder falls and he's like, running up that. All right, my name is Peter Girl. Thank you guys very much. Yeah.
All right, hell yeah, man.
Great stuff. Hold on 1 second.
Alright.
My god. Okay, so we have to be done by 1 a.m. so we're gonna get everything. Okay, January 22nd, brake lights make snow. Alright, is Addison Anderson here? Probably not. Okay, how about Mina? Laura didn't think so. Matthew House didn't think so. Alright, so yeah, we have to be done by 1 a.m. I wanna come up, do a little thing at the end. We have Joe Levy on deck. Let's get the hilarious, one of our favorites, one of the masters, the guy, the philosopher, brilliant conversationalists, great human being, great sense of style. Give it up for Danny Fallon. Everybody.
Yeah! Yeah! Woo!
All right, good to be here, huh?
Woo!
Yeah, I'm feeling inspired. I'm going to tell a story. It feels like a good story night.
Woo!
For me, most of my good stories happened over a decade ago. I jammed all of my stories into about 4 years, and now I have no stories. No stories are being generated. I'm living life, but nothing is happening worth, because nothing can compare to a story like this, right? So Lee Paul was talking about masturbation, and it got me thinking about some of the weirdest situations in which I've masturbated, you know? So this is, you'll keep that in mind. And we'll go along the journey together, and at some point I'll end up masturbating in the story. All right? So, I was speeding along. I was a speed freak. I was taking amphetamines. You guys are familiar. I had been up for a couple days. I was speeding along, going through life. It's a great drug. It just feels like limitless all the time. Like, that's what that movie's about. You know? You're like, I'm gonna write an entire rock opera in 2 minutes, and then you just jerk off for 10 hours, and then you compile a to-do list, and then you reward yourself and jerk off for another 10 hours, and then you're like, I'm gonna use all of this energy and my mental is so good. See, now I don't have the amphetamine, so I can't string together a good sentence. You know, but back then you're like, oh man, my verbal linguistics abilities is so good, you know. See, that's what I'm saying. But anyhow, but you end up using all of this energy to just masturbate. That's what you do. So I was speeding along, and I went to go smoke a blunt with my friend Paulie Lucas. He actually called me earlier today, and I don't speed along through life, so I didn't answer it, you know. But that's what happens, you know, friends change. But anyhow, Paulie Lucas called me. We go over there to smoke a blunt at his house, and he's like, you've been out for a couple days. Here, take this Xanax, it's gonna help you out. So he gave me a 3 milligram green Xanax triangle.
Oh God!
And I take it, and I had begun experimenting with Xanax at this point in my life. I had a few prior experiences, you know. So I was feeling good. I was listening to Long Train Running by the Doobie Brothers.
Ah, yeah!
On a computer basement, and I was having such a good time that Paulie was a little alarmed. He's like, "We gotta get out of here. My mom's coming home," you know. So next thing you know, I am near my drum set, some in a different location. That's like the next memory. And then the next memory is like, and I'm like, that's really cool that I drew all this stuff on this floor tom. And then the next memory is like a vacuum cleaner, and I'm asleep, and I don't like that. And then I say something, Mom, you're a bitch. And then I'm in the garage, and my twin brother is in front of me, and he's very upset with me. And I'm like, I don't know why you're so upset, dude. You're not being very chill about the situation. And so I start pushing him around. He's like, please don't push me again. You're not gonna like what happens. So apparently I push him. He punches me in the face. To this day, I'm the only person he's ever punched in the face. And this sobers me up immediately. I'm like, all right, I'm out of here. So I run into the driveway where my friends were waiting for me. I was in a band called Dream Journal at this point. And for some reason, they were in the driveway already. So now I am just in green Grinch boxers, nothing else. I run into the car. We go over to my friend Jake Masolak's house, right? Then we're over there. Jake Masolak was one of the only people I knew who could just have a hypodermic needle laying around, and when heroin happened to come around, he could just shoot heroin and then not do it again. I did not have that experience myself, but that's for a different night and a different story. This is pre-heroin Danny. So I go over to Jake Masolak. Jake Masolak hooks me up with some psych ward gown threads. And also before I left my house, I grabbed my yellow Crocs. So now I have yellow Crocs, Grinch green boxers, and a psych ward gown. It's like July in Indiana. And so we hang out as long as we can, the band, but then they're like, you gotta leave. And now I have no cell phone, no wallet, no form of identification. I walk about 20 miles in Indiana, and it's not like New York where you can just walk. When you're walking in other parts of the country, people are like, wow, why is there someone walking here? Especially when it's a country road and you're wearing a psych ward gown. So I walk all the way to where my high school was, and I show up at this girl's house who I knew, you know, vaguely, right? And I knock on her door, and I'm like, it's me, you know? And she's like, all right, she's like 18. And so she takes me in, and her family takes me in for 3 days. I sober up, and I have the weirdest fucking dreams in my life. All the dreams involved massive green triangle Xanaxes in her medicine cabinet. Maybe a weird sex dream about her mom. I don't know. But her brother gives me some clothes. I'm wearing real clothes now. I have jeans. I have a t-shirt. I wear out my welcome there. I'm a newly sober person. I walk out into the world for a new adventure, right? 3 days sober. I walk to the other part of town, to my friend Nick Iraq's house, who I also Facebook messaged earlier today. And because we blew off prom night, the next day after prom, everyone was like, hey, we're gonna go to the city, Chicago. And my date messaged me and was like, everyone doesn't want you to come if you're gonna smoke weed. And I was like, screw you, you squares. And then I proceeded to just smoke a quarter ounce of marijuana with five dudes in a house. And then also at some point left that because that was boring to jack off in my car. And I should have known at the time that that was going to be foreshadowing for the rest of my life. Just five dudes smoking a quarter ounce of marijuana, you know, whatever. But anyhow, that's not the story, and that's not the masturbation from this story. We're getting there. All right, so now I walk to Nick Irak's house. Me and Nick Irak start smoking weed. I haven't smoked weed in 3 days. At first, it's going good. Well, no, before we smoke weed, he says, Dan Fair, who's dead now, but Dan Fair, heroin, you know, it'll get you. And rest in peace, baby. I tried to get him sober. I helped. But anyhow, that's not here nor there. So Dan Fair was going to come over with Molly and girls. I was excited about this. I love taking Molly. I used to take Molly for days in a row. 2012, I took so much Molly. I am now so sad for the rest of my life. But it was good while it lasted. Yeah. I don't know if you've ever been so high on ecstasy you dress up like a woman and masturbate to your own ass. But I have been, you know. So Dan's coming over with women, real women, so I can maybe come to something other than my own ass, and Molly, apparently. But then I smoke weed. Terrible idea. I get so high on weed, all that low self-esteem, inner monologue comes back. I'm like, you're a piece of shit. Everyone hates you. The girls are going to hate you. Dan Fair is going to hate you. Even Nick Irak, who let you into his house into smoking weed with you, he hates you. So I'm like, I got to go for a walk, Nick Irak. So I go for a walk. And at first, I just walk around the neighborhood. Then I come back. I see Dan Fair's car. I'm too paranoid. I can't deal with people. To this day, this still haunts me. The idea, like, people still terrify me. I still feel permanently stoned sometimes. But we get through it, you know. We take some vitamin D and we try to exercise, and that's the best you can get later in life. But you have your fun while you can. Some people, they spread it out. Me, again, jam-packed it for 4 years. But so then I'm like, all right, what can I do? So I decide to walk the 20 miles back to my parents' house and just see what's up, you know. So I'm stoned. So I'm walking there. About 10 miles in, I'm on this country road, and I'm like, I'm still too high on pot to deal with human beings. You know what would help me is if I masturbated. So I'm on this country road, there's this big driveway to this house, and there's like shrubbery. And so in my mind, I have to decide, will it be worse if a car drives by and sees me jerking off into shrubbery from this angle? Or will it be worse if I hide myself from the cars and then these people, if they happen to look out their front window, will see a man masturbating into their shrubbery? I went with the latter, and so I just masturbated in about my prom date, actually. I remember distinctly, to this day, I don't know why, she's a comfort jerk. Does anyone here have a comfort jerk? Just someone you're like, maybe if life would have gone a different way, we could have ended up together if I wasn't so broken inside. And to this day, I'll just imagine, like, it's like a wholesome masturbation. It's like, we were high school sweethearts, I never made those poor choices, like, that's my comfort jerk, Gabby Touche. Love you, babe. But, you know, anyhow, she's getting married. It's fine. Sometimes the fantasy now is that she's cheating on her husband with me. Not as wholesome, but whatever. So then I walked home to my parents' house. Wasn't allowed in the house. My older brother came out, and we were talking. And for some reason, he was like, I don't know why you fucking curse so much. And then he punched me in the back of the head. And he is not as strong, so it was laughable. It was comical. But yeah, so the story is bookended by both of my brothers punching me in the face or the head. And yeah, that's it. Thank you so much.
Preach, preach, preach. Unbelievable. Danny Fallon. All right, let's get the hilarious Joe Levy up. Give him up. We're closing it out. I'll come up at the very end and do a little bit. Andy Sleaze, we're getting Andy Sleaze replays. Give it up for Joe Levy.
Hey, what's up, guys? How you doing? Yo, Danny, you are an animal. That is crazy. Also, you promised a story about jerking off. You delivered, man. It took a while, but we finally got to the big conclusion, and that was yeah, exactly. I was like, when is he gonna jerk off? Oh, he jerks off. Oh, so if someone like gets tripped out from smoking weed, that kind of made me feel good. Cause he smoked heroin, meth. He's like, yo, this weed is crazy. Like, I feel good now for tripping out on weed if Danny had a heart attack trying to fuck hookers and do meth. And he's still like, yo, I'm seeing some colors right now. That felt good, man. Thank you, guys. Thank you. I had a long night. I was drinking, but I feel like this is a good room for all that stuff, man.
Yeah.
It's a good room for that shit, man. My sister married a fat guy, and I'm not happy about it. Because she was a smart girl. Like, she was too smart to marry a guy that fat. She was valedictorian 2 times. She counts the pie, he eats it. She is a scientist, he's the size of the lab. He's a fat guy. And listen, this is America. I don't hate you if you're fat, truthfully. Most of you guys aren't, I feel like. No, most of you guys are not fat. I don't, thank you. You were looking good. No, of course. Game recognizes game, man. I told you I was drinking, man. Yo, listen, I don't hate the guy because he's fat. I hate his excuse for being fat. It's a bullshit excuse. He's like, yo, Joe, I'm allowed to be fat. I work as a caterer. So? I know someone who's a firefighter. He's not also a burn victim. I know someone who makes clocks. He doesn't time travel. Like, again, your wife is breastfeeding. She's not drinking the milk. It's ridiculous, man. And now, because the baby's fat, and the baby cries all the time, and I think it's because he's fat. The baby's crying because he's a baby, and also he knows what a fat guy his fucking husband, his father is. Again, I don't hate him because she's smart. She should know better than that. Like, she was valedictorian, beautiful lady, and she married a fat guy. That's like winning the Olympics and tripping on the podium. It's like you were just there. And I don't believe anything he says. Like, sometimes he'll use like a baby talk voice and be like, oh my god, what a cute baby. I want to pinch it and I want to eat it. Like, you know, he means it. He's going to eat the baby.
Oh my god.
How fat this guy is. It's not about him being fat, it's the fact he lacks impulse control. Like, he'll look on TikTok while he's driving. Like, yo, take a second, brother. Breathe. I can't judge. I have bad habits. I drink and drive. It's horrible. It's not good. I misspell all my text messages. I vape. It's not good to vape. Unless you want to feel amazing. Unless you want to get pussy. I had this guy's vape. The vape flavor was vanilla ice cream. It gave me lung cancer and brain freeze. It's like, do I do chemotherapy or chocolate sprinkles? Fucking brain freeze from a vape. I don't know what to eat. I don't know what to eat, man. I don't know what to eat. A lot of people bite their nails because they have anxiety. Not me. I just enjoy the way they taste. Alright, here's the thing I have, right? My sister's a vegan. She's like this vegan feminist, and I love her, man. She actually taught me a lot about life. She told me I could follow my own path, do what I want to do. And she thinks eating chicken is wrong because the chickens had horrible, horrible lives, right? They're born on factory farms. It's disgusting. You guys know, right? The thing is, I think eating vegetables is way worse because they had amazing lives. Every tomato you ate was chilling in the sun. He was experiencing photosynthesis. He was getting a hand job from nature. Like, you ruined a tomato's life. That chicken is an Auschwitz for no reason if you don't eat him. That chicken is suffering. You have to eat him or else he dies in vain. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah, a little bit, Matt. You got a t-shirt on, though.
It's Indie Sleaze Night.
Ah, that's what it is. Yeah. I thought you were going through it. I had the t-shirt on. This is crazy. All right, I think I can say one more thing. I appreciate you guys saying, I know Matt can do his thing. I'm going to take you, just check one fucking thing on my phone. Let you guys go. Thank you so much for, I really appreciate it. You guys are a great crowd.
Yeah.
Thank you. My parents are away, right? I love my parents. They're away. All right, I'm partying, man. It's funny because you know the speech your parents give you before they go away? Like, what about you if we die speech? You know that speech? Your mom's like, hey, Joe, if we die, I have a pair of earrings upstairs. I want to give it to your future wife. Yeah, like she wants to prepare me if she dies, what I should do, you know? So she has these earrings and she wants my wife to have them if they die, you know? My dad, he's like, yo, Joe, I have a cabinet in the basement. I need you to burn it. If a half son, a half brother in China, connect with him if you miss me. All right, whatever. Thank you guys so much. Give it for Matt. Everyone, thank you. Hi, Proctor. But first, we are dark aristocrats of the nights, setting fire to the switches so they stay warm in the snow. Okay, so this is my Guns N' Roses poem. It's called Chinese Democracy. It's me. Hi, I'm the problem. It's me. Karaoke. Everybody sang Guns N' Roses. The tattoo artist and the heroin addict. Doing heroin in the bathroom at the fucking hard time. Punching the needles down the fucking drain. Punching the needles that the government can't bring down the fucking toilet. Spending 25 cents in the fucking toilet cause it costs money. I rent the hotel by the hour cause I have sex with my mistress. And the prostitutes doing blow. The prostitutes, we are doing blow with Guns N' Roses. Fucking Axl slash Guff. The cunts, except John Ryder, child of friend. In the Navy, who sang Secret Agent Man. Sing Secret Agent Man. Or Pantera, fucking hostile. Who likes Pantera? Pantera won the Super Bowl! Man, fucking Tara, Dimebag Darrell, rest in peace. We love you forever, brother. We love you, Dimebag. We love you. I wanna die. No. To fucking hostile, fucking hostile, fucking hostile. They had dollar pitchers, and brand representatives were on hand to give you free Happy Camels if you let them scan your driver's license. John Ryan vomited in the backyard. Then he picked a French fry out of the puke, and he re-ate it. He hated the French fry. He ate the fucking French fry out of his own puke. When Rat Boy was a gas. People who look like Danzig were horrified. People who look like Danzig were horrified. Glenn and Henry were horrified. Oh, Rat Boy was horrified. But we were proud. We salute you, brother. We salute you, John Ryan Jobs. We salute you, Guns N' Roses. Drinking double Captain and Cokes at Thunder Jackson's. Puking on the side of Tommy's mom's minivan all the way home.